We have only a little bit of time, and I know a lot of people here want to meet Brad, and there's usually a group of people around, and so excuse me, I'm going to talk really fast and try to get this up and ask some audience questions. So can you handle a quick fire?
Let's go.
Okay. So just to kick things off, quick thoughts on the Snap IPO itself, what it means for tech industry and investing, and is a consumer window closing?
I am not a Snapchat user because I'm too old.
Be Feld on Snapchat?
I mean, I have one, but I don't even have it on my phone. So I don't have much emotional connection to the company. I think it's really good that it's going public, and I think more, I'm sort of the Fred Wilson school of thought is I think more IPOs are good. I think one of the things that has been manufactured that's an inhibitor of a lot of activity is the fact that companies are not going public. I don't really think there is a window per se of consumer or not consumer. This is the endless discussion. Oh, there's no more opportunity to do X ever again in the history of mankind.
I mean, Fred kind of wrote that a few days ago in not such a direct way, but he all but, in my reading of it, closed the door on consumer internet digital media.
Well, so let's define what consumer internet digital media means, right? Will there ever be a new product that is ubiquitously used from a consumer perspective that is in the universe today that we're thinking about? Absolutely. And is it something we haven't thought about yet today? Absolutely. Is the ability to raise a bunch of money on a relatively small user base and a prospective view of the future available to people? Probably not. Right? So the shift is, instead of it being a whole bunch of people trying to get money into stuff and a whole bunch of things getting created, focusing more clearly on what you're doing as an entrepreneur that's playing ahead of the next wave of what's going on. We go through this over and over again. I mean, every single layer of whatever the new hot trendy thing is. 4 years ago or 5 years ago, I was on a panel that some other publication, not to be named, did, and the panel was about big data, right?
I remember that.
And you know, the headline that of course got printed was "Big Data is Bullshit." And you know, my comment was this thing that we're calling big data 5 years ago is going to be microscopic data in 20 years. So the dynamics of all these things are continually changing. It gets renewed. I think the idea that there's somehow a window that's closed is doing a disservice to anyone who has a creative vision about the future. The notion is the way that things have been funded for the last 5 years and the opportunity space that exists may not exist going forward. But that doesn't mean the next thing's not going to get created.
Okay, so quick fire two. In this current boom cycle or the last 7 to 8 years, have VCs in general been too friendly?
No. I think that there's two different pieces of friendly. Friendly piece number one is, you know, warm, cuddly teddy bear. And most VCs who are warm, cuddly bears are actually warm, cuddly polar bears, which means that they're really wonderful until something goes wrong, and then don't fuck with them. Right? That's one vector of friendly, like as the person and the interaction, the way that you relate. The other version of friendly is passive about dealing with terms and about dealing with setting expectations at some point in time in the context of a company. So this phrase that's, you know, maybe 10 years old now, founder friendly, it's kind of like the problematic cliche. What does it actually mean to be founder friendly? The far extreme of that would be a phrase I use all the time, which is give first. And this idea that you want to enter into relationships non-transactionally. Right? You put energy into something, it's not altruism, you expect to get something back. You just don't know when, from whom, over what time period. Well, the extreme case of founder friendly would be, hey, here's $5 million, no contract, no nothing, and send me back whatever, whenever, right? And obviously that's not how it works. So I think you get this marketing illusion of what founder friendly is as a way to obfuscate what the true character of the people are. And my advice to entrepreneurs is to recognize that it's not a situation that's generic. Right, the archetype of VCs is not a singular archetype. There's not a founder-friendly VC. There's a whole bunch of different personalities. And the context of where they're investing, how they behave, how they interact with you, that defines it. So the last comment on what is not a quick fire is on the scaling of our VCs too founder friendly or not founder friendly enough, kind of my view is on the dimension that I care about, which is my job as a VC is to help you win, period. And as long as I support the person running the company, I work for you. I don't think VCs are far enough on that end of the spectrum.
Got it. Okay, and there's a lot of chatter about, let's say, non-Bay Area, non-tech companies buying tech startups as sort of a bailout, if you will, or reinvention. Do you think a lot of that is chatter, or do you think we'll see more of that over the next day?
Big industrial companies buying tech companies for way too much money because they don't know what else to do? Yeah, so...
so no, yes.
I asked the question. In any cycle, and you know, the whole world that we live in runs in cycles, and it doesn't matter what that cycle is doing and whether it's, you know, sloping up or sloping down, or it's a cycle that has, you know, different kind of, you go to a certain place, you go down to a certain place, you go back to a certain place, you go down, so it doesn't matter. In cycles, you have big movements that are directional. Those big movements, when they happen, are often happening after it's too late to actually have the appropriate impact of it. I've been doing this for 30 years. I've been investing for 20 years. There are continuous cycles of non-technology companies entering into the world of trying to buy technology companies, going back well before I started even my first company. And a small number of those companies extract really significant value out of that because they buy well at the right time on their curve and they're able to do something with it. And a whole bunch of companies don't get the value for their investment. It will depend on which category, right? You know, you could talk about the auto industry, you could talk about the consumer products industry, you could talk about retail. I think they're different. They're in different phases of the cycles. They're doing different things. You know, they're spending different money for different reasons. All of them chasing innovation. The idea that chasing innovation, creating innovation within their companies, doing it in a way that is acquisition only, I think is kind of nonsensical. I think it's a strategy. You know, as somebody who is very involved in Techstars, I think the strategy of that we're using at Techstars where we partner with large companies and build accelerator programs, not for the large companies, but for companies that are building things around the ecosystems of those large companies, is a very inexpensive way versus spending capital and buying, you know, a team of people that's effectively a startup and an early product. So all of those things can work and all of those things can fail. It happens over and over again. If you're an entrepreneur and you're trying to time that, you will get fucked. And if you're an investor and you're relying on that, from an investment perspective, it won't work. You will either get lucky or you won't. If you get lucky, that'll feel good. You'll start to believe that that's an extrapolated trend, and then the cycle will change on you again.
Oh, man. Okay. So I polled a lot of people before and then tonight and trying to figure out, okay, if we could talk about two topics with Brad, what we go into. And I think I carved it into two topics. Second one, we'll talk about just Foundry and evolution of Foundry next. First topic, I think a lot of people in the room are sort of investors, thinking about being investors, maybe starting angel investing. What I thought we could do, Brad, is kind of walk through the ramp of how someone gets in today, maybe goes from angel to like managing other people's money, and maybe building something larger than just a one-man shop. And you know, the first question I would ask you is, let's see here. What would, for new people entering the world of VC, this could be a small fund, medium-sized, big fund, what would the tips be from old Brad and, you know, tips from young Brad? Not old Brad, but today's Brad. Sorry about that.
I'm sorry. 51 years old, I got it. So I didn't totally get the question. So the tips for doing what? For how to progress from angel to being...
No, so like if you're entering the world of investing...
I got hung up on the old thing.
Yeah, so that was my fault. If you're entering investing, you're managing a small fund, medium, or part of a larger fund, you know, what would your advice have been, you know, let's say 10, 15 years ago versus now in 2017?
Yeah, okay. So I think my advice probably 10 or 15 years ago would have been irrelevant because I don't think I had enough time doing that. And in fact, you know, it's 2017. If you go back 15 years ago, I was in the middle of working through one of the biggest shit shows that got created in the venture business, which was you know, the collapse of the internet bubble. And I was part of a firm called Mobius, which grew from 4 people to 70 people in 3 years and raised almost $2 billion over that period of time and had one awesome fund, one terrible fund, and one fund that, depending on what happens, might make some money, right? So by my horrifying year was 2001, where like everything fell apart. And by 2002, it was still horrifying, but at least it wasn't all falling apart because it had almost all fallen apart. And now I was trying to figure out how to do something with that. So if I wind the clock back 15 years, I don't know that I would have had good advice. Even 10 years, which was when we started Foundry Group in 2007, we started Techstars in 2006, I had a bunch of, I would say, deeply held beliefs, frame of reference, things that had been that I had been involved in that I had done wrong, or that I participated in that had been done wrong that I had reactions to. So the younger Brad, I think, would have had probably some opinions and hypotheses, but wouldn't have been able to give advice. Interestingly, one thing that I do feel like I could give advice on is how I went from being an entrepreneur to angel to VC. And the way I did that was deliberately from entrepreneur to angel. I sold my first company, and I took almost all of the money I made. I sold in 1993, made a couple million bucks, bought a house, and then took all the rest of the money except $100,000 and invested in 40 companies over 3 years, $25,000 to $50,000 at a time. 94 to 96, particularly good time to be investing in internet startups.
But you put your own capital risk. You didn't seek other people's.
That was. I'm now an angel. It's my own money. This is the mistake. I then started working with this venture fund. It wasn't a venture fund. I started working with this very large organization called SoftBank, a Japanese company. It had a few people in the U.S. that were making investments. And they didn't have a big team in the U.S., so they leveraged the U.S. team by having some affiliates. Those affiliates, for those in the room that are study history, were me, Fred Wilson, Jerry Colonna, who became Fred Wilson's partner at Flatiron, and Rich Levendoff, who was a partner at a firm called Avalon. We were the affiliates. SoftBank was investing tons of money really fast. We were all very busy doing deals. SoftBank then ran out of money. And 4 of us started what became Mobius Venture Capital. It was originally called SoftBank Venture Capital. The 4 of us were accidental partners. It was not a deliberate choice. It kind of was a reaction to a moment in time, a lot of stuff happening, us working together, and 3 of the 4 of them worked at SoftBank. But then we created a venture partnership, and we didn't do the work of really creating a firm basis for what we then grew very, very, very quickly. You know, the predictable thing happened. So the advice I would give is really simple. It's be deliberate. And especially true in this environment where it's relatively easy to raise a very small fund. It is harder to raise the next level fund, and then it's harder again to turn that into something that's more than a single partner that's sort of scaled up from angel. And if you look at the 500 or so funds that are in that cycle right now, an awful lot of them are not going to be successful. And so as both investors and entrepreneurs, the idea that it all just continually goes up is a mistake. So this notion of being deliberate gives you a starting point for deciding what you're going to do over a very long period of time.
On that note of proliferation of seed funds, is there any more room for more funds, either geographically, sector-based, in the U.S.? I mean, clearly there are going to be more funds started, but what's kind of the end game?
Yeah, I don't think that supply of capital is the problem, especially globally. I think that there's always a supply-demand imbalance, no matter where you are, no matter what time we're at. Generally speaking, the only layer of capital that a particular geography can impact is the seed stage. So if you're in, pick a city, and you're trying to, as part of the city, whether you're an entrepreneur, investor, or government, or something else, you're trying to impact the city. Your goal should be to focus on that seed stage, because pretty much every city in the world, there's a bunch of rich people, and they give money to things like museums and symphonies and whatever. And those rich people could give their money to startups instead. And at least under the current tax code, they get kind of the same tax deduction if the startup fails that they get if they give it to a museum. So they should just think about it as, you know, for-profit philanthropy. Because the worst case is that it turns into something and they get 10, 15, 20, 100 times their money. But they're building the economic fabric of that community. So that layer can be impacted. The growth layer, you know, once you've got a business that's working, that money will travel anywhere. And the sort of $2 to $20 million financing, turns out that's a bitch everywhere, including here. Right? There's never too much of that, even here. And that challenge of that layer is really difficult.
And that's a function of fund size, right?
It's probably a function of a lot of things, right? You have a place where, I want to say this carefully, there's an enormous amount of work at the whole cycle around investing. The work at each stage is very different. When you're at the seed stage versus you're that 2 to 20 million stage and then you're at the growth stage. Getting good at doing that work in the 2 to 20 million stage, it's really hard. And it doesn't necessarily translate if you're really great as a seed investor to all of a sudden being really great at that stage. And if you're a growth investor, almost by definition, you're probably not going to be really good at that stage because the characteristics are so different. So there's a lack of supply of people who are really good at it. And because of that, in the short term, you might be able to have a surplus of capital at that stage, but in the long term, the capital is going to go to returns. And so if you raise capital at that stage and you can't get returns, you're not going to be able to raise future capital. Or you're going to realize you're not good at that stage and you're going to move up or down on the spectrum. So I'm being careful because I don't want it to sound like, oh yeah, there's seven good people and there's a whole bunch of shitty people. It is probably the place though where there's the biggest constraint of capability.
So let me spit that back at you another way. Are you saying that there are funds that are composed of managers who have the skills, capabilities, backgrounds to handle, let's say, a $2 to $10 million check, but that also have a fund size that allows them to do that?
Yeah, I think that's right. If you have a very, very large fund, you know, if you have a $1 billion or more fund, it's very hard to write checks of that size. We experienced that at Mobius, right? And it's two things. One of it's just hard to do the velocity of deals. The other is cognitive dissonance. I remember so vividly that moment where when I went home at the end of the day, I realized that I had massive cognitive dissonance. And it's when somebody said, oh, it's only $5 million. Let's just do it. And everybody said, okay, it's only $5 million. No big deal. And we had a $1.25 billion fund. But for me, as a startup entrepreneur who raised no money, my first company was self-funded, $5 million, what are you talking about? Right? But I participated in that. The cognitive dissonance was, I'm like, yeah, okay, whatever. I'm like, wait. Right? So you lose sight of it as the fund scales up because it's just incremental. By the way, a $200 million fund, the equivalent of that is, oh, it's only another $1 million. And if you're really good, you'd make a deliberate decision across that $1 million. The other end of the spectrum applies too. You spend so much time torturing the entrepreneur over $1 million investment. Right? So it's sort of figuring out what the right balance is, especially once you're an investor in a company, because that's where you lose money or make a lot of money.
For Foundry Group, I know typically it's been $225 million. Has there been the same number of core investments in each of the vintages?
Yeah, each fund has about 30 companies, plus or minus one, I think 28 to 31. So. Yeah. And each fund that we've done, we've invested over 3 years, again, plus or minus a quarter. We do not have a consistent pace. We like to say we do about 10 new investments a year, but it's not one a month. We'll do a whole bunch in January and February, and we'll look at each other and say, like, out for a while. And then, you know, somebody will see something in April or May again, and go, and all of a sudden we'll, right? So it's not that we're too busy, it's just the sort of notion of it's lumpy based on what our interests and proclivities are. We're not trying to manage against an allocation, but we are trying to do pacing. We had 1 year where we did 14 investments, and at our annual meeting, at our advisory board, we had a couple of very vocal investors, one of whom is a partner of ours now, Lindell, who is our largest investor. And Lindell said, basically in the advisory board meeting, the equivalent of, well, you guys slow the fuck down. Like, you know, you said 10, you did 14, you're going to hurt yourself. Not you're going to get bad returns, not you've done bad investments. You don't have to do, you know, this fast is not good for you. Not good for your soul.
new people entering the VC world, how would you advise creating a brand and attracting deal flow today? If someone's just starting, maybe they have an angel portfolio.
I think that I'm going to separate attracting deal flow from building a brand. I think attracting deal flow is a function of knowing what you like, who you like, and how you like, and then spending a lot of time doing those things. And the reason that's so important is that if you spend your time doing those things and you're aligned with what you like, how you like, who you like, you'll nourish yourself. And the effort of getting started and finding deal flow is really hard. Right, and it's very easy to find people that want to raise money. It's really hard to find things that are worth investing in. And so you have to be doing it with essentially whatever you can configure in your favor when you're just starting out. I think the idea of you have a really good network and your network just brings you stuff, well, two things. One is your network runs out of things at some pace, but your network brings you everything. It doesn't filter. If you say no to certain things, your network stops bringing you things. If you say yes to everything, you're going to be a crummy investor. Right, so it's sort of figuring out how to build that feedback loop. The brand, I think, is extremely personal because I've seen seed investors be successful who no one knows who they are other than the companies they've invested in, and they're very not visible. Then there's people like Semil Shah, who everybody knows who they are. Right, so you put a lot of effort into writing and talking about your ideas and getting known. I think that's good. You can be deliberate about it, right, very disciplined, or you can let it be your personality. My view is that you do it as your personality. You're very much you. Now, last piece of that around building a brand is that all the bullshit marketing stuff is be authentic, be transparent, like whatever, right? The words that we've overused to the point where they're meaningless, that really just mean do and be yourself in the context of how you're interacting with people and let your brand or whatever you want it to be emerge from that. And people will sort into people who are attracted to you and people who are not attracted to you. And that's okay in this world because the goal shouldn't be that you're trying to invest in every single company. The goal is that you, every time you write a check, you think it could be a great company.
Let's assume for a second that we're close to or at some point there'll be a down cycle. I think a lot of people in the room, myself included,
what?
I know. Haven't actually seen
There's
it.
No way Donald Trump is going to be elected president. It's just not
And so at some point it'll happen. I don't, myself included, we've read about it, we haven't seen it. How do LPs and VCs behave in the cycles that you've seen when things have changed very quickly?
Well, it's a combination of overreaction and total denial. So those two things happen simultaneously. And we actually had a pretty good taste of it in Q1 of last year. Right? I mean, there was a two-month period when the market went down, whatever it went down, public markets went down, all of the, call it what you want, but sort of later stage, hedge fund, growth capital at very high prices vaporized, so those guys stopped playing, the crossover guys stopped playing. All of a sudden you had these companies with, $5 million a month burn rates that were going to, were counting on raising that next round. And for a two-month period, the world was going to end. And then it didn't. Right, so kind of this combination of these two emotions.
And there were huge, multiple billion-dollar funds raised in Q1 as well.
Yeah, well, Q1, actually, I think first half of last year was the most money ever raised, right? So, you have, it's a good point, you have dislocation of activity based on time. Anybody here ever played the MIT beer game? Nobody, it must be on the West Coast.
Looks like there's one person.
Yeah, did you go to MIT? There's a very famous game from the 1980s at MIT, which is called the Beer Game, and it's a four-stage, it's a game that everybody that goes to business school plays, and it's a four-stage supply-demand, sort of supply chain game. So at one end of the spectrum is the retail purchase, and at the other end of the spectrum is, the people making the hops or whatever, and there's four steps, and you have a demand equation on the front end, and each turn ripples through one, and you don't know what the other ones are, and you think it's a 50-turn game. And so you sort of build inventory and do things as though it's a 50-turn game, and it ends on a random turn. So it could end at 21 turns, it could end at 37 turns, and it's amazing. No matter what people do, the same kind of behavior occurs, which is that when the demand is high, you create an overproduction cycle that has a time lag, That's roughly the length of the supply chain, right? So it's roughly a 4-turn lag. So if you can, if you're playing it optimally, you're taking its quarters, you're 4 quarters behind what's happening. So now you've got all these VC funds that have tons of money, and everybody's saying, oh, the world is ending. Who does that benefit? It actually benefits the VC funds, because the entrepreneurs now want to raise money on terms that they can raise money on because they're afraid they're going to run out of money. Or maybe it doesn't benefit the VC firms because the people that have the money are not the ones that were the early stage investors. So all of a sudden the early stage investors are getting capital piled on. Like, it's just, it's not consistent. And so it's holding these two notions together. The challenge is the denial dominates, right? So you want to hope it's not going to suck. And you sort of push off your behavior longer. And I think in what happened at the beginning of last year, a lot of companies slowed their growth, slowed their hiring rates. A lot of companies lowered their burn rates, grew into sizes. Some companies raised money opportunistically. A lot of people just sort of focused on their business. And then this year, but they still grew. And this year, I think a lot of those companies, I've said a few times, and I see it in all the planning, those companies are, at least in the planning in our portfolio, many of them are having very shallow growth for years. They have a lot of revenue growth, but they're staffed enough. They can grow into where they're at. Interestingly, if you push denial out long enough and the problem stays, so the problem that we had last year continues out, you know, that we had in the first 2 months of last year continues out for 12 months, all of a sudden you start to have structural problems. And then you have this massive overreaction, right? Then all of a sudden everybody turns upside down and stops doing something. So it's interesting to reflect back on 2000. I think 2000 had an extraordinary amount of venture capital raised, Connie would probably know. But it was, you know, at the time it was like that was the peak amount. And that was really the signal of the oversupply of capital. Now, I think there's different dynamic going on this time around, both in terms of the globalization of the activity, the amount of activity, democratization of innovation, so it's not just geographically centered. But you have the same kind of problem, which is that you will have an oversupply in certain stages of whatever, and you'll have a macro dynamic that somehow impacts that. And you know, ultimately, you always have plenty of tears. The question is whether when it is painful for that whatever period of time it's painful, you have the fortitude to actually keep building. Last comment for people. 2000 and, does anybody remember 2008, 2009? Wasn't that supposed to be the end of the universe? The end of our entire financial system, right? For startups, didn't even notice it. But for startups, they were just starting to emerge again, right? So it's so interesting how as humans, we calibrate our cycles. You've never been through a downturn, but anywhere, it just wasn't a downturn that directly impacted you because the world you were living in wasn't the one that had this massive downturn.